and she went to hug me, but because my nerves and my nervous system was going insane, when she did, it felt like fire. And so that's like my first memory of like, something's not quite right. So my mum was an actress, mm-hmm. and when she was 7 months pregnant with me, she performed a one-woman show about pregnancy called From Here to Maternity. And so, yeah, when I was 7 months fetus, I was on stage each night.
You're right. So was it any surprise that when you came out that when you said to mum and dad, you know what, I'm going to be an actor, were they even remotely shocked?
I don't think so. I mean, I don't remember a time in my life when I didn't want to. I was like a very gregarious, outgoing, flamboyant child who would constantly be like, there's footage of me as like a two-year-old dancing the Little Mermaid soundtrack on repeat.
And classics though.
That was amazing.
Right?
And I didn't even know what drag was, but I did Spice Girls for the years 1 to 3, and I did Ginger Spice, obviously.
Naturally. I can see you as Ginger.
I actually didn't realize at the time that Ginger meant redhead. I just thought it was like a spice, you know, like, great double entendre, you know, like.
So, at the age of 11, a PE teacher notices you favor your left-hand side. Mm-hmm. And what goes through your head at that moment?
I mean, as an 11-year-old, I didn't really have any concept of what it meant. My mum had a really strong gut instinct that something was wrong, and she took me to a number of specialists, and then they found a tumour filling 90% of my spinal cord cavity from C1 to C7. And I went to have a biopsy test to see if it was cancerous or not, and I went in and there were complications for the biopsy. I became quadriplegic, so paralysed from the neck down, and then I spent 6 months in hospital.
When you woke up from the biopsy, what was the first sense that something had not gone to plan?
So basically, I came out of the biopsy, I was fine. I think it came out at like 3 p.m. and then about 6 p.m. my right arm started getting pins and needles. Mm. And then my right leg, then my left arm, and then function was being lost. And over like 12 hours, I slowly became quadriplegic. My sister, who was 5 at the time, she was there and she went to hug me, but because my nervous system was going insane. When she did, it felt like fire. So then I screamed and she started crying right away. And so that's like my first memory of like, something's not quite right. Like, But then we went to Sydney and to get second opinions and you know, see what we should do. And a lot of them were saying that his spinal cord is obviously very compromised and it needs to, the tumour's inoperable and we don't know anyone who'll operate on it, but it needs to be removed. But then Charlie Teo, the amazing neurosurgeon, said, I can operate on it. And he did and removed the entire tumour. My disability's just been the paralysis from that, the complications from the biopsy. After the initial biopsy, I was quadriplegic. But where I got to after the 6 months of rehabilitation is I have full function back in my left arm. I have full function in my left leg. I have partial paralysis in my right leg. And then my right arm is almost completely paralyzed, so I can feel hot, cold, pain, pressure, but I can't feel texture or light touch.
Oh, okay.
So I can't really tell what's holding me, but I can feel that something's holding me. All throughout high school, I used a mobility scooter.
So there's a standard amount of pressure that comes with being a teenager, and everyone struggles with that.
Mm.
But what you're talking about is something that has multiple layers on top of it. And I guess I'm trying to understand what you think the long-term impacts on your personality, on how you interact with people are out of that.
It's like the stuff I've gone through, especially like in terms of acting and stuff, I gave it up. I gave it up when I became that age as well, because even though as a kid, it's all I wanted to do. And it wasn't a far off concept. I was auditioning for kids' TV shows. But when I became disabled, I really felt like, well, now this isn't a feasible career path. And so I can't do it. And just to make matters worse, when I went back to school, it was the same time that I realized that I was gay. I realized when I was like 12, 13 that I was gay, and I very consciously decided to act straight. And I remember there was the cute boy in year 7 who I won't publicly name, but I remember I had a
probably for the best.
I had a crazy crush on him. He was just that
that guy.
He was just that the 12-year-old who just got attractive.
Yeah.
To other 12-year-olds. this is not going well.
No, it's going fine.
And then there was the pretty blonde girl who he was dating as much as you do when you're 12 years old. And I remember seeing them together, and because my body no longer felt like my own, I felt like there was this sense of, oh, if I looked like her, then he wouldn't know that it was me. Mm-hmm. And he would look at me the way he's looking at her. He would want to kiss her like he wants to kiss her. He would want me in the same way. But at that time, I wasn't like, I'm gonna make a movie about this. But in hindsight, that was totally the germ and genesis for my feature film, which is about a gay disabled teenage boy who has a full body transplant into the body of a beautiful woman so that he can make his straight best friend fall in love with him, who's 17, not 12.
Again, probably for the best.
Probably for the best.
I'm good.
You had ruled out acting.
Yeah. It was only 2 years into writing, or maybe even three, that I even decided, you know what, if I'm ever gonna act, then this role is based on me. Like, there's no one better to play this role. Like,
I'm still hot enough to play a 17-year-old,
exactly,
that's fine.
Exactly.
The other interesting thing about that is that even now when we talk about disabled people on screen, by and large, those roles are played by able people.
Very by and large. There's also an issue in that the dominant narrative we tell about disabled people is from an ableist perspective of an abled person imagining how terrible it would be,
yeah,
if I became disabled and how I'd overcome my disability, yeah, at the other end. Which is a really, look, it's a very dramatic, interesting one that wins a lot of Oscars, but yeah, it's not the entire disabled experience.
And yet, weirdly though, this conversation will adhere to that arc in a
totally,
way.
Totally, yeah, totally, absolutely. But I mean, for me to be able to do what I've done, has never been a case of overcoming my disability. It's often those narratives are, I will defeat my disability to be able to do this thing. The only reason I can do this thing is because of an accepting and embracing of it.
What is the representation of disability that you've seen on screen that just made you furious?
That's a good question. Indley, I think it's Artie, the wheelchair user. There was an episode I remember seeing, and the character was in love with the blonde cheerleader or something, mm-hmm, and he said, oh, my dick still works. Being a teenager who not only has the visible stuff, but also is incontinent and impotent, it's really hard to ever imagine that you could ever have intimate relationships. Well, biologically, would another person be able to be aroused by my body? I remember I used to go to bed each night, and the two things I most wanted to change about myself was, one, I didn't want to be gay, and two, I didn't want to have to wear diapers. I would wake up every morning like hoping something would change.
What was the moment when you realised that you could have intimate relations, that somebody else could be aroused by
totally,
your body, that you are still a sexual being?
For the longest time, like, I didn't lose my virginity until I was 21, and that was like a revelatory moment. Once realising, oh, people could be attracted to me, then I really went to town. And
what would 12-year-old Daniel make of this film? Just stepping into school for the first time, feeling that sense of isolation, what would he have made of this film?
I made this film for 12-year-old Daniel, and so, like, I hope it would make 12-year-old Daniel feel seen and less alone, and also give him hope for what his life will be.
And I guess that's the power of filmmaking, particularly cinema, is about giving yourself somebody else's eyes, right?
Totally. The more people can not only intellectually understand, but like emotionally empathise with other lives, then the more, I feel like the less judgmental we'll be, the more accepting and embracing we'll be. Yeah.
Daniel, you are an absolute pleasure to talk
not
to.
Not at all, thank
I
you.
I really appreciate your time.
Thank you so much.